valley, won't cut your knee. In the quiet, won't cut your knee. In the shadow, won't cut your knee. At my breaking, oh God, you need, you need, oh God, you never leave my side. Your love will stand firm through all. My searching won't cut your near. In my wandering won't cut your near. And when I feel alone won't cut your near. At my lowest won't cut your near. You need. You never leave my side. Your love will stand firm through all my life. Cause height nor depth nor anything else could pull us apart when you're joined as one by your blood. And hope will rise as we become more than conquerors through the one who loved the world. And height nor depth nor anything else could pull us apart. We are joined as one by your blood. Hope will rise as we become more than conquerors through the one who loved the world. Oh God, you never leave my side. And your stand firm through all my life. You know, God, you never leave my side. Your love will stand firm through all my life. You never leave my side. You are always faithful. Your love will stand firm through all my life. My sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Know your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. And my shame was a ransom, you faithfully bore. And he canceled my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. Washes over me. You have made us new, now life begins with you. And it's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. My Savior displayed on a criminal's cross, and darkness rejoices though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made us new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love, it's your endless love. Bring down on us, you have made us new, now life begins with you. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. When death was arrested, my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Jesus, we know that we have new life in you, and we thank you for that today. God, I ask that you would speak to us, that you'd open our hearts and our minds wherever we may be, in our specific ministries, in our specific groups. We praise you, God. You are awesome and worthy of all of our praise and adoration. Be with us today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hey, Refuge, and welcome back. So we are still doing our series, Tough Questions, where you guys send in questions and we do our best to answer them based off of what scripture says. And so last week we talked about judging and what does God say about judging others. And this week we're gonna talk about prayer. So Jeremy's gonna kick us off in answering the question, does prayer really change things?
Yeah, and so that's a question that people ask all the time. Does prayer, is it effective? Is it helping anything? And so One thing that I want to point out is that God uses prayer to change us and our lives and our hearts. And so I'm going to point out two things that God uses prayer to change in us. And the first is that prayer shifts our perspective on life. And so a lot of times we get caught up with the things of the world. And so our culture is kind of thrown and shoved down our throats, and the TV shows, the movies, the social media, the news, everything is just, our culture is all around us. And we can get caught up in that. And so a lot of times we need to take a step back and pray and think, okay, God, I'm not supposed to think the way the world thinks. I'm not supposed to view things the way that our culture views things. And so that's difficult when we live in this world to still view things through the Bible. And so prayer is a time to step back and say, okay, God, I want to view things how you view things. I want to get a biblical perspective on things. So God, help me to shift my perspective on how I'm looking at the world, how I'm viewing people, how I'm viewing you. And so a lot of times we need to just step back and change our perspective on the world around us. And so that happens every morning for me, because I know naturally, I don't know about you guys, I wake up grumpy, I wake up selfish, and I wanna serve myself and do what I need to do, and thinking about what I'm gonna do today and how I'm gonna accomplish certain things and what I need to do to serve myself. And so a lot of times, I just have to step back every morning and say, okay, God, I'm gonna read your word, I'm gonna pray, Lord, shift my perspective. I don't wanna be a selfish person. I have to remind myself that my life isn't about me. It's not about making my name known. It's not about serving my desires. And I have to say, God, how can I serve you? How can I bring you glory? How can I serve and love other people? And so it's that shift of perspective every morning that prayer can bring, as we take a step back, shift the perspective from ourselves into onto God and serving him and serving others. And Romans 12:2 talks about this. It says, do not be conformed to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And so that happens through prayer, right? We're reading God's word and we're praying through that. God, renew my mind, change the way I think, change the way I see things, the way I see myself, the way I see people. And so prayer is a way that God uses to change our minds and change our hearts. And that's the second thing that I have for us, is that prayer aligns our heart with God's heart. And I say this all the time, that a sign of Christian maturity is your heart will begin to look more like God's heart. And so you're gonna love the things that God loves and hate the things that God hates. And so as you grow closer to Jesus, right, you're gonna want to have your heart look more like his. And we see people pray this all throughout the Bible. In Psalm 19:14, it says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. And so that's something that we want to be praying, right? God, is the things that I'm saying and the things that I'm thinking and meditating on, is my heart acceptable in your sight? Does it look like your heart? And so we'll see that the more our heart looks like God's heart, the more we'll closely follow the two greatest commandments, right? Jesus tells us that our two greatest commands are to love God with all our hearts and to love others as ourselves. And so when we begin to have our heart look more like God's heart, both of those things will fall into place, right? Because we're gonna love God more. The more we pray and spend time with him, communing with him, talking to him, the more our heart for him is going to grow, and the more our heart for other people is going to grow too. Because I've seen this in my life. When I have bad relationships with people, we just struggle, we don't get along, and it's hard for me to want what's best for them. When I start spending time praying for them, right, and I come to God and I say, God, help this person, help our relationship, help them, Lord, I want what's best for them, then you will actually begin to want what's best for them. Mm-hmm. The more you pray about it, you bring it to God and you ask him to help that, then you're not thinking about yourself, right, in that prayer. And then you begin to actually desire what's best for that person. And that's a great way to soften your heart towards people, right? Mm-hmm. And people all around, right? You'll have a heart for the lost. You'll have a heart for those that God has a heart for. You'll want people to come to a knowledge of the truth, just like God does. And so prayer will shift your perspective and it'll align your heart with God's heart.
Yeah, great. Some things that I'm going to focus on just talking about prayer and how it changes things is it kind of aligns with some of what Jeremy was saying too. But one of those things is that prayer can change our habits, or it can become a habit. And so something that a lot of people say is like, oh, well, we're just praying, or like, don't just like pray when you eat, or like pray before you eat, or like pray before you go to bed, like pray all the time. And that's so true, like the Bible talks about us praying continually. But even in those times of praying before food or praying before you go to bed, it's so good to pause and see God in everything. Yeah. And I kind of talked about this last week in the judging video, but sometimes we function as if there's like a no God zone. Mm-hmm. And that's just not the case. Like God doesn't not exist in some places. And so, but because we live in a world that is not centered around God, or at least our society doesn't, like our culture isn't centered around God, sometimes we kind of live in that way where we don't really, we kind of separate God from things. And so prayer is a really good way to be reminded of the fact that like God is in everything. Praying before you eat, praying before you go to bed, praying before you drive, praying, mm-hmm. I mean, obviously junior hires, we're not driving yet, but praying before you take medicine or something like that. Just remembering that like God is in everything. God's not separate from the food I'm eating or this surgery I'm having or anything like that. And I think it's also wise to set time aside to pray just so that you don't forget maybe some things that you wanted to pray for. Like, it's hard for me to like do, like always set time aside because just sometimes like schedules are just really like crazy. But I know usually before I go to bed at night, like it's a time of quiet. And so I know that like I can sit and just like fall asleep and like pray, but like praying to God and like praying about different things that came up throughout the day or thinking about people. And then even like, I remember when I was commuting to CBU for a little while, I towards the end of my semester, my freshman year, I would just make a prayer of like, I mean, a habit of like praying in my car on my way to school that morning. And the second thing is that prayer helps us to see God as friend. And so this is something that really right now has been the most impactful for me. And there's a song, it's called What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And my favorite line is, I want to make sure I get it right. It says, oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. And I noticed, like, for me, I tend to like when big change happens, like the first 2 days, I'm just like spiraling out of control. And I'm like, this is gonna happen. Everything's gonna be terrible. And then I'm like, okay, well, you need to be praying about this. Like, what are you doing? And I have a tendency to call a friend first. And I have great friends, but there's been many a times where like I'll be calling, like nobody's answering the phone, and I'm like, okay, I need to pray about this. Like, I need to come before the Lord about this. And there's Philippians 4, and if you read verses 4 through 7, we'll just read the whole book, but if you read verses 4 through 7, it talks about rejoicing in the Lord, and it also talks about prayer, but I'm going to read verse 6, and it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And this doesn't take away from different feelings of anxiety that we might have. Like sometimes people will quote this verse and be like, stop worrying. But really there's an opportunity here to come before the Lord and say, okay, God, this is what my heart is concerned with right now. And just to bring our concerns before God. And God is, we see even in like the Psalms, which I love, even recently, just like reading through the Psalms, I'm like, this is so relatable because it talks about times of rejoicing. It talks about times of like lamenting and sorrow. And it talks about just like sadness. And you can even go through the Psalms and pray those prayers and just reflect on those things because the Bible isn't separate from like real life. Like sometimes it's really easy to see the Bible as like a book of stories that are like good and cool about Jesus, or to see the Bible as like something telling us all the things we can and can't do. But really the Bible is stories about real people living real life with God, you know? And so they're just expressing, especially in the Psalms, expressing just really like real emotions and real things that are going on. And so I do think that prayer can help us to see God as friend. And essentially the Psalms are prayers to God. We're talking to God. And just like Jeremy said, like prayer helps us to do what God wants. And so we do see like in the Gospels, Jesus praying with the Father before going out and if Jesus is praying, then I think that prayer is good for us too, you know? And so just going back to what Jeremy said about culture, like we are easily so filled up with that, especially right now when even though we're kind of like in between these stages mm-hmm. of quarantine and like somewhat normal life, like so much Netflix, so much like YouTube, so much everything. And like, that's not bad. Like it's not bad to watch a show on Netflix. But it's easy to fill yourself up with all of the concerns of like the world and all of the, just craziness. And so just be mindful too of like, what am I filling up myself with? Am I filling myself with like time with the Lord? Or am I filling myself up with time with the world? And then even in that, as we pray, we have to remember too, like we still need God's word. And so when we're praying, that's not like separate from Bible reading, or that's not separate from spending time with God in his word. Like God is going to reveal something to us outside of his word. And Thomas says this many times where he's had people come to him and say, God is calling us to do this. And he's like, no, God is not calling you to do that, because his word speaks directly against that. Like God is not going to call you to do something that is different than what his word says. And so we just need to be mindful of that too as we talk about prayer. Prayer definitely can change things, and we'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute, but prayer is also, it changes things as it aligns with God's will, and we see God's will in his word.
Yeah, so, exactly. Yeah. And one thing I want to clear up is that a lot of times when people talk about prayer, they think that prayer is a conversation with God, which is partially true because prayer really is just us talking to God. And so when you think about having a conversation with God, really it's God speaking to us through his word, and then we respond through prayer. And so don't think of prayer as you sit and you pray and you tell God these things and you're just waiting to hear a voice and get a feeling and get some kind of gut reaction where you're like, this is God, this is him, this is what I need to do. But prayer is just responding to his word. So this is how God speaks to us, through his word. And so when we pray, we don't expect to hear God's voice from heaven. We have that here, right here. We have everything we need to know from him to live godly lives, to be wise for salvation. And so everything we need is in his word. And so when we pray, we can come to him, we can talk to him like it's a conversation, but we should expect to hear back through his word. And we communicate our thoughts in prayer, and he communicates his thoughts in his word. And so we just want to be clear with that.
Yeah. So then, with all this being said, the question, does prayer actually change things? So, like, if I pray for somebody to be healed, or for people that don't know Jesus to know Jesus, or if I pray for straight A's, or for my parents to not get divorced, or something like that, if I pray for that, is something going to change in my life? Is that thing going to happen?
Yeah. And so one thing we don't want to think about God is some kind of cosmic genie where we just tell him whatever we want and he grants our wishes, because that's not how it works at all. And we see this. We pray for things all the time that we don't get, right? I mean, I have friends that I'm trying to witness to that I pray for all the time. I don't know if they'll become Christians. I don't know if they'll be saved. But there's comfort in knowing that God does know and that God is in control. And like you've said, you've told me times where you pray for years and years and then they finally do become a Christian. Mm-hmm. And you don't know when it'll happen. You don't know the timing. And so we have to trust that God is in control, right? The word that we use is sovereign. God is sovereign over all things. And so a way to look at prayer is that you've used the word partnering. So we're kind of partnering with God in accomplishing his will. And so we always want to pray for God's will. And going back to when I talked about how prayer changes us, is that prayer can be seen as a time where we bring our requests to God. We bring everything before him. But eventually we're struggling through those to get to the point where we say, okay, God, this is what I want. I see my situation. This is what I desire. But God, ultimately, I want your will to be done. And so prayer is a time where we can talk through that with God, and we can tell him all of these things. But eventually we have to say, God, your will needs to be done, and that is my greatest desire. Mm-hmm. And so no matter how bad I want this certain thing to happen, Lord, I trust you, and I pray that your will be done and not mine, right? That's what Jesus says in the garden, right? That's the example that he sets, and Jesus is God, and he prays to the Father, Father, your will be done, right? And so We can't treat it as, I prayed for this and this needs to happen, mm-hmm. right? And so if that's our attitude, we need to check our hearts on that, check if we're submitting to God and submitting to Christ, and ultimately trust Him over ourselves, right? Mm-hmm. And I can look back, and you'll see this too as you grow older, things that you've prayed for in the past that I am so glad that I did not have, right, granted, because we don't know. We think we know what we need and what we want, and we really don't. And there's so many things that I thought, man, I need this in my life, God. Mm-hmm. I really want this to happen.
Yeah.
But that thing doesn't happen, and I look back, and I'm like, gosh, I'm so glad that that is not how things turned mm-hmm. out, right?
Yeah.
So we have to trust God in that.
Yeah. And, too, God may bring about the thing that you were praying for in a way that you didn't see it. So the answer might be yes, whatever that looks like, but it may not. Yes may not be delivered or occur in the way that we thought it would. And we may not even notice sometimes. Like, I think that there's been times where now looking back, I'm like, oh, wow, like God answered that prayer. But I just thought it was going to happen like this.
Let's close in prayer. We have this great privilege to talk to God and bring our request to Him. So let's close in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful for this privilege to be able to talk to you, God. Your word tells us that you listen, that you care, and that you love us. And so, Father, we are so thankful for that. I pray for each of these students, Lord, that we would all know that you do care, and, Lord, that we can bring our requests to you, God. And so I pray that we would be strong and constant and steadfast in our prayer lives, Lord. That would be a means for you to work through our lives, God, to make us look more like you. God, would you use our prayers to shift our perspectives, to help us to focus on you, and God, to change our hearts. Father, we pray for a youth group whose hearts look exactly like yours, who love the things that you love and who hate the things that you hate, God. I pray that you would grow our hearts for you, and that you would grow our hearts for others, Lord. Would we be a people who chases after the lost, who pursues those who do not know you, God? Would we strongly desire for all people to come to a knowledge of you? Jesus, we love you. You are everything to us, and we submit our lives, our wills, our hearts, our minds. God, we submit everything to you, Jesus. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, you guys. So just as Jeremy was praying, our hope is that as you reflect on what you learned today, that you can just consider what you're filling yourself up with during this time, and just bringing your cares and concerns to the Lord, because He does care, because we do have a friend in the Lord, and also just being mindful of reading God's word and reflecting on that and understanding just what God wants you to do and His will for your life. And so that's it. We're wrapped up Tough Questions, and we'll see you guys in the fall.